This is just a preliminary introductory talk, making you familiar with what exactly is all this. This is one more. Let me go another way. Wait. This talk will focus on my experiences with the Ilizarov system. But before we start, let me disclaim that I am not an expert Ilizarov surgeon. I have never been to Berlin or Russia. I have never been formally trained in the system under anyone. I learned this rather than was being taught. However, I experimented a lot with the system. I learned from my mistakes. I conducted 63 workshops on Ilizarov. And I was the first to introduce the system in 1986-87. To Malaysia, Singapore, Sri Lanka and Bangladesh. Because those times I used to make a company, run a company that used to manufacture these implants. I conducted a lot of experimental studies, led the literature, attended conferences, and even now, conferences like this teach me a lot more. In 1991, I wrote a book, and the latest edition of this book has become a bestseller, on to its next edition. This talk will focus on very simple things. Biomechanics of bone healing and callus formation, logic behind original Ilizarov principles, and the magic of Ilizarov, the man and the machine. We all know bone has got periosteal and endosteal blood supply. And whenever a fracture occurs, a hematoma forms, which stops as soon as the pressure equals the blood pressure. And this hematoma is a nidus on which callus forms. So, for every fracture to unite, the first nidus needed is a fracture hematoma. And what good would a hematoma do inside a suction bottle? That is exactly what we do when we convert an open fracture, a closed fracture, into an open fracture. Second thing is cyclic axial loading. So, absolute rigidity does not unite fractures. Small micro motions in the beneficial direction is the one that unites fractures. See, that's a classic photograph from Ilizarov's original book. That is a guy with a fractured humerus who had undergone 7 failed surgeries. Last of all, they put a silastic plate inside the medulla and cemented it, bone cement right to glue both ends. And you can see still the non-union with that piece sticking out. The second X-ray, Ilizarov's primary compression frame was kept for only 37 days and the fracture failed. So this is the basic thing of the original Ilizarov system. An Ilizarov system is an intrinsically dynamic system giving beneficial micro-movements in the linear axis while providing outstanding stability in torsional and angular axis. So this makes the patient functional from day one. You can see a guy with a forearm Ilizarov riding a bike and this guy used to drive a car. This allows almost immediate weight bearing and directly helps blood flow and muscularization. You can see here this guy with a tibial plantar fracture is driving his car. That guy used to drive his bike. You saw another one doing his stunts. But all these beneficial effects are retained only as long as you use K wires and tension them. Even a single Schwann screw screws up the biomechanics. So, one in the middle is the original Ilizarov frame. You can see the few number of holes. And you can see the 1990 spread, and you can see the very thick rods and pins. And if you look at these two pictures, they look seemingly unconnected. What is the connection between the two? There's a battery tank on the left and a bicycle on the right. It was the gasket of the battery tank and the spoke of a bicycle, which was used by Ilizarov in early stages to manufacture his first Ilizarov apparatus, because in Kurgan, near his hospital, these were the two industries that were running. In my view, this is not an Ilizarov assembly. See the amount of chance they are sticking right throughout, not single K-wire. Neither this an Ilizarov, neither this an Ilizarov. You can see chance pin sticking out at every place. See the chance pin coming out. Putting a tibial chance pin in Ilizarov does not, that makes it no longer remain a Ilizarov. Let's go back. What happens if we don't treat fractures? What happens to animals with fractures? why occasionally fractures don't heal despite multiple surgeries? Is there any absolute indication of internal fixation? These other questions plague us. We've been asking them repeatedly. Wild animals are generally don't go to a bone set on orthopedic surgery, yet their fracture heals. Animals with fractures know that the broken limb is to be kept immobile until pain subsides and they gradually return to function. An untreated horse is walking in 2 months. Look at this dog with a very bad fracture, malunion, and look at him in 6 months. How beautifully he is running, absolutely no treatment. Untreated fractures invariably heal. It is very, very rare to see a non-union in a fracture that has not had treatment. Malunion, yes, it will malunite but not kept in a tight position. But physiological non-unions in untouched fractures was practically unknown before internal fixation entered our scene. It may heal with shortening, yes. Invariably it does, as in the case of tumor. It may heal with overriding. But it heals nevertheless. Every single fracture heals untouched. So, the worst by nature cannot compete with the worst by man. Something like this, or this, or this, or even this. In surgically fixing a fracture, we delay any surgical healing. We deliberately convert a simple closed fracture to an open fracture. And all internally fixed fractures will heal slower than conservatively treated fractures. An infected non-union for a surgeon is just a statistic. But for the patient, it's a lost job, a missed examination, a ruined career, a groom or boy being denied marriage, the whole household in debts and misery for years. For him, it's 100% disaster, multiple surgeries, prolonged morbidity, and hell of a life. Micromotion of the fracture site has a very important role. Minute movements of the fracture end stimulates the throwing up of callus. A rotatory micromotion will produce what is called an elephant foot callus. An angular micromotion will produce what is called a horse hoof callus. Minimal compression distraction in a linear direction with protection from rotational angular stresses will cause healthy callus. Fractures can thus be treated with rigid immobilization with compression plate, semi-rigid immobilization with nails, non-rigid immobilization by plasters or splints, rigid immobilization by external fixators, and dynamic immobilization by traction or flexible external fixators. We all know in compression plating, there's a race between fracture healing and the plate breakage. The fracture heals first, all is well, else the plate is going to break. In nails, rotatory instability, unless they are locked, may cause hypertrophic non-union, and if you lock them, no longer compression is available, unless you dynamize it. If you forget to dynamize it, the nail will self-dynamize by breaking the screws, as nature still attempts to heal. Rigid external fixators are very stable in two axes and unstable in angular stresses. And Shan spin, unlike K-wires, exhibits a ductile behavior and loading will cause bending of the Shan spins that you have seen in all these cases. Here is where the Ilizarov magic enters, and that is one of his classic cases where he had lengthened the leg. What are the magic components of Ilizarov? There are only four. Use of thin wires, tensioning of these thin wires, corticotomy, and control distraction. So, a few words about each. Originally, Ilizarov used nothing but pins. Even in proximal femur, he used to use only pins. And these pins were capable of being tensioned. By substituting Shan screws for K wires, we lose the magical advantage of the inherent dynamism. Subsequently, you'll be hearing from experts like Shibujan Varki and Mohammed Yunus, who will show brilliant wire placements almost across every corner of the body, safely and comfortably. Tensioning is a process of stretching the wire so that it becomes taut like a piano string. So a tensioned wire of 1.8 millimeter diameter is stronger than a 7 mm Shan spin. and still inherently elastic. Quantum quantum is just that using a special chisel, you break two-thirds of the bone in a circumferential manner and crack open the back. There you can see how the chisel goes in and how it is broken. And you have got an intraoperative picture of a chisel doing a quantum quantum. And the fourth magic is controlled distraction, both for bone transport and elongation. You can see the gap non-union of femur, a quantum has been done, it's being pulled down by 2K wires, and there's the degenerate that forms, and there the joints are downstairs. If you do not respect the original concept of the designer, the results will decidedly be inferior. It is essential to understand the difference between a stretched wire and a stiff pin. Elasticity of the wires, especially the tension wires, helps in the Wolf's law. Look at these two. What is the difference between one and the other? One has spokes, one doesn't have a spoke. And the one who doesn't have a spoke needs something extra, a shock absorber. So a bicycle does not need a shock absorber, because the spokes themselves absorb the shock and resist the deformity. On the contrary, when there are no spokes, you need a shock absorber. That is why in AO1 tubular fixators, after a particular stage, you loosen the rod to clamp connection so that linear telescoping comes in place. So, an Ilizarov fixator is a multi-axially intrinsic very dynamic system because of its tensioned wires. So you mess up when you change. The brilliant results with all wire frames can hardly be matched with the Shanshan system. This is a very short video which will show what all can happen with the magic of Ilizarov. Let's see if it's playing. That's a compound fracture who was advised a cross leg flap. We just put Ilizarov and use the pins first enclosure. They are walking on day one of the surgery, day two of the surgery. That's in a week's time. You have done some skin grafting. Patient has been mobile throughout the period. That's at 57 days. So, no plate will make a fracture in 1957 days. That is a fractured talus. And calcaneum, and this is Dr. Kirkpatrick's own technique. He has just used two half rings and four wires, got the angles right, got the joint correctly positioned, and there is the movement of the patient, you can see. And 7th or 8th day of surgery, how brilliantly the patient is functional. You can just see five wires. There is an acromocal for the joint. It's again not my case, and to be one of my friends, and using olive wires as joysticks. With a single plate, it has been kept in place and the fracture united in 6 to 8 weeks. That's a forearm, it was plated, plate removed, put a bone cement was poured, pouring first, failed masculate. And here he is on the day of surgery, post-operatively moving his hands beautifully, and subsequently he is fully functional. This guy was notorious, he got arrested, he was in prison, he got beaten up with a frame in his hand. And then he came back to me for removal, by which time his transport was over and his ulna had regenerated. Here we can see that Ilizarov frames are fairly easy to remove. You don't have to take them to the theater, you don't have to give them anesthesia. You can do it well in the clinic. And just by reassuring the patient, nothing is going to happen. That's a bowler button. Treated by just three pins and one and a half rings, that the day of surgery, that the fracture stretched apart, there he is at 28 days, there is function, including finger movements. This frame was removed on 55th day because it was a 3 month old fracture, and there he is immediately on removal of the frame. We are not able to see full rotation because he is rotating the shoulder. For the next picture, he will do it properly. There he is function, and there was his radiology, and there he is. And that's him. At the end of 6 months, when he got his son with a practical magnet, and he is doing all his activities on a rig, climbing, hanging himself and doing hard labor. That's Shastra 6, treated by Ilizarov, multiple key wires, olive wire and tooth wire in the proximal fragment. That's 4-5 days post-surgery, the amount of movement the patient is getting with a 5-8 frame. He's still on the frame, should be removing his frame in another 3 weeks. He's now almost 60 days down the line. He has eliminated the use of a walker quite soon and is walking full weight bearing with a smile on his face. And this is the guy who even sent me a video of him driving his car inside his house and asked me, is it alright for him to drive a car for short distances? And naturally I asked him to send a video so that I can show it to you and boast before you that Ilizarov is not a huge or a cumbersome apparatus which is incompatible with normal biological function of the patient, as is expressed and proclaimed by non-Ilizarovians. That's a femoral bone transport with segmental loss of femoral bone, again getting up and standing within 24 hours surgery. You can see all these are the post op ward itself. You can see the type of ward they are in. So they have not yet been shifted to the rooms. They just come back from the surgery and before shifting they are changing their dress. So that's a manual fixator in a child who is smiling. So this is basically not as painful a procedure as people usually think it is. It's a short quick procedure and in all cases the fractures heal much faster than with any form of internal fixation. Heat removal, internal fixation keeps the bone together allowing function but does not facilitate union. Ilizarov does not hamper function and propagates union. This ankle arthrodesis, again at 10th day, the patient is encouraged to climb stairs. So I am not putting the x-rays and all to be shown eventually. I am just showing you the functional capability in ankle arthrodesis after complete fusion of the ankle. That's him, completely painless and comfortable. That one was very interesting. This is a fracture which should not have been touched in the first place. Went to a corporate hospital and they put disc. And you all know what will happen in such plates put in humerus. He once turned in his bed and that happened. Then they said, no, no, we will not put a right plate to you. We will put a better plate to you. And they put a phyllos. Now again, short working length. And made his stress sensor in the bottom. He is a huge fellow, 120 kilos. Now what do you think is going to happen here? This happens. Now what is the choice? They want to put another long fellow. I said, no. Something which I am going to do is to throw all this, forget all this hardware, get your fracture united first, we'll take out the hardware when it's necessary. So I didn't touch the existing hardware. And I put on a humeral frame. There he is. This was done completely at local anesthesia and use a nerve stimulator in the humerus to ensure that the pins are not touching any nerves. And that is the final picture after we have put in the frame. And because he was done under local anesthesia, he was fairly comfortable on the table. He is coming on rather good and we should be able to remove the frame in about a month or 6 weeks time. There you can see how hugely built he is. But the frame is rather very comfortable for him. There's one or two chances on the top. Otherwise, it's a fully all wire construct. So, I think these examples give you a very rough idea of what this system is capable of. And this last case will show you why Ilizarov is indeed magic. Child, neuropathic, equine of Kevobrasford. Discharging fungating leg, not walk for 5 years, everybody advised amputation. Immediately after surgery, she had walked with a plantigrade foot for the first time in her life. There she is, was on 21st day. This frame was kept for 90 days of correction. Very playful child, running around, never bothered with the frame. And it was removed in 3 months' time. There she is, in 6 months, how she has grown, gone back to school, plays sports, drives a bike. There is there she is about year, year and a half. Because from getting like went away, her hunger and appetite returned and started eating well. And other parts of development also started. And there she is exactly 2 years after surgery. She rides a bike. She plays football. She goes to normal school. And she's rather practically happy. So this is how magical the system is. And how good your girls will come with this. Now come the important questions which our dean was also telling in the morning. If this is such a wonderful method, why is it not so popular? Second, what is the reason for decline in the number of cases for which this system is being correctly used? As he said, 1985 to 2005, it was massively being used. 2005 to 2010, it declined. 2010 to 2015, it still declined. Now we have a rising trend because in 2015, I conducted my first conference in Delhi. And a few of the faculty here were the participants there too. Between us, we formed a small group called SSEF, Society for Study of External Fixators, where we shared our mutual experiences. And between us, we developed many techniques which are not given in the books, which we couldn't disclose to the patient or share with others because people call us mad. Using Ilizarov for a fresh college fracture, using Ilizarov for a fresh closed calcaneal fracture, these things are not known or written in the literature. But we found such outstanding results. Practice in 26 days, 27 days, 28 days. It's simply unbelievable. So we will share some of those experiences with you today. The reason why Ilizarov lost its popularity is not hard to understand. Number one, deviation from the original design. Second, gilding the lily. What is gilding the lily? Already the product is very good. But no, I'm going to improve it. So I'm going to add this, I'm going to add that, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. Internal fixation devices are very easy to use. Unlike Ilizarov, which needs a lot of thought and planning. And plates is a fit and forget job. It's a fit and forget job. But here, it's online maintenance. Bad workmanship, few improperly applied frames have got a very bad name to the whole system. Of course, commercial considerations, you can see the prices. The cost of the Ilizarov set is far more than plate and H2. However, the system is reusable. Effective cost for somebody who has a balanced inventory like Dr. Yunus or me or Dr. Langer or Himanshu, it is as cheap as a plaster. All it requires 4 or 6 wires, everything is reusable. We use it the first time. You might spend 10, 15, 20 thousand for each frame. Two misconceptions which should be cleared in the conference here itself. Long learning curve. No, there is no long learning curve. After 2 days of lectures and demonstrations, you can go back and apply your own tibial frame with absolute confidence and excellent results. That's what I am guaranteeing you today, one of the main purposes of the conference. Difficult procedure. Again, we are going to show you, it's not a difficult procedure. The actual passage of wires takes only 15 to 20 minutes. At the most half an hour, irrespective of the limb. Adjustments of nuts and bolts outside and minor fine tunings that take more than an hour in many cases. It is neither time consuming to take, to learn, nor time consuming in the OT because I did a small audit of my cases and in the initial stages, my operating time for an average Ilizarov was twice of my knee replacement. Once my numbers became high, now current last year's audit, I take more or less the same 15 minutes, 45 minutes in and out of either knee replacement or the procedure, respective of anything. The only place where I exceeded was a shaft of femur. So this is not a time consuming procedure. You need the same theatre, same assistant, and the same team to help you, the same assistant, and you'll be able to do it very easily. This conference will teach you, we are very much in time. This conference will teach you when not to, and how. This will teach you to apply a basic tibial frame and apply a basic distal radial wire frame. You continue to learn as you teach, take these lessons back and pass them on. Knowledge expands only by sharing. Thank you very much. So I think we are extremely fortunate that we started on time at 10. The first talk is over at 10:27. We have 2 or 3 minutes for talk. In the meanwhile, I invite Dr. Ramprasad Pandiswamy, who is our next speaker, who will be introducing you to the components of the Ilizarov system. Now, all of you have got PDF files listing the components. I hope you would have just glanced at them once and got familiar with the names. Now, after Ramprasad's lecture, correlate the pictures in your mind with what he is telling you, and then you go for the workshop. The first step is to identify the components on the table. Okay?